I'm just going to say some words about Willa Cather because I've just been deeply moved by her. When I was writing The Point in Pittsburgh, and please buy them for God's sake, I got an empty out in my garage badly, and I got a leaking roof. So please, $20 for The Point in Pittsburgh, 460 weighty pages. But Peter was one of the great commentators on the book. There were so many people like Bill Sarin and others, but Peter, one of the things he asked me is, "You got Willa Cather in there." And I said, "Willa Cather, isn't that Nebraska, the plains, you know, the wind sweeping on the wind?" "No," he said, "she lived in Pittsburgh for a decade." And so that really started me to write or begin to understand her a little bit. He pointed me to several things I should read, Paul's Case. And that's why I'm so honored here to have Jake here to talk about his dad and what he meant to us. He was a very important person in the history of the Battle of Homestead Foundation and our love of poetry and of writing. And Jake was continuing that legacy, and we really appreciate it. He'll talk just a bit about his book on first high school. Peter's, this here, thanks to the CMU giving it to us, I said the hell with the result for $5. So please get the Pittsburgh Stories of Willa Cather, and it'll go in the book fund. And like I said, please buy that. There are many other things. The other thing that came along with Willa Cather was that when the first published, I took this around the Post Gazette, and I had took a stack of them up, gave it to different people. They never reviewed it because it was self-published, even though I had probably the four premier experts reading it and had numerous experts. But anyway, it had to be published Union in Pittsburgh, and we had to control the story, so that's why it was done the way it was done. But Len Barkowski, the Post-Gazette, says, first thing he said to me after I gave it to him, he says, "I'm so pleased you put Willa Cather in there." So I have said, well, I remember that ever since. He was also one that, like Peter, who had a great love. And the more I read, the more I understand why people love. And so I won't get into the other stuff. I know we're going to talk about her visit to Homestead and to Pottersville, which I was really pleased because I didn't even remember that I'd written in my book that that she was Isabel McClung, her great friend, was the daughter of the judge at the Bergman trial, and it is in my book. And also I had a quote from her visit to Potterville, which I know is going to be talked about, Potter being the superintendent of the mill here in this 1892 strike, and that's what the workers called the scab housing, was Potterville. And she's pretty devastating in her description. So that's the first thing, is class consciousness. Thing that just blew me away by my Antonin reading it is, aside from the gorgeous nature writing and the love of nature and the power of nature and the smell and the touch and the feel and the work and the respect for work is so deep in Willa Cather. But the one hilarious one that you got to read in here called Golden Slipper, about a gal who's an artist and stuff versus a capitalist guy. And he's haunted all of his life by the one chance he had with her. And it doesn't happen, but it's a terrific opposition of female exuberance, life, art, music, whatever, versus counting your money, thinking how I can get ahead. I mean, it's devastating. Sensitivity to the natural world. Nebraska, New Mexico, Quebec, all scenes that really are moving out of her books. And finally, the woman view, because I cannot wrap my head around that it's a man that's the narrator. It's obviously Willa Cather. Come on, Will, I know you had a very interesting relationship with gender and sexuality, but I cannot read it as a, I keep reading it as, maybe I'm moving, but you guys can say that, but it just is such a powerful thing. So the last thing I wanted to say before remembers at the end, Maya Antonia, coming in with her work team along the evening sky, lent herself to immemorial human attitudes which we recognize by instinct as universal and true. She was a battered woman now, not a lovely girl, but still had that something which fires the imagination, could still stop one's breath for a moment by a look or a gesture that somehow revealed the meaning in common things. She had only to stand in the orchard, put her hand on a little crab tree, and look up at the apples to make you feel the goodness of planting and tending and harvesting at last. All the strong things of her heart came out in her body that had been so tireless in serving generous emotions. That's Willa Cather. So, with that said, we are going to invite our poet, Leanne Norman, will open. Leanne is someone I've known a very long time in our association with Molly Rush and with the resistance in various ways in this town, anti-war. And then we're going to follow Jake Oresick, who will talk about his dad and his thoughts about the connection with his dad and Cather. Kim Vanderlaan, really appreciate it. She was the first one that come, I think I confirmed for this in the, at California University of Pennsylvania. All these are the Catherites, I call them, not Cathars, which is another thing I'm very interested in. But at any rate, California University of Pennsylvania, Kelsey Squire, who drove the longest and came from Columbus, right? I really appreciate your efforts and looking forward to both of you. And then Timothy Bentram is the guy that really helped pull the Cather side, the scholars together. So I really, really appreciate that, and I loved his PowerPoint, and they're running through Europe, getting back to good. Hopefully we'll see that his PowerPoint on the Homestead. Finally, Len Markuski will kind of wrap it up, and then we'll open it up for questions. I know there are other passionate people in the audience who love Willa Cather, so after we each get our 10 or 12 minutes, we'll open it and hear what you have to say. Thank you very much.
Well, I'm so pleased to have been invited to read a poem at this gathering that I showed up a month early. So I want to thank all of you for helping to celebrate Willa Cather, who's one of my favorite writers. And in my new book of poetry, Way Station, there are some copies back there for sale, there's a poem about Willa Cather called That Clean, Strong Voice. I hadn't remembered how uncluttered her prose, the just right word, a woman telling a woman's tale, new to grasslands, plains, how it is to be a stranger, almost newborn in the middle of a mysterious continent. I felt special kinship to Willa Cather because I'd gone to college on the plains, and we'd had the chance to buy the house Cather lived in during part of her decade in Pittsburgh. I remember wondering if we'd find handwritten pages behind a radiator, tattered notes in an old closet with fusty wallpaper. We bought another house two blocks from where she'd lived. My book club chose My Antonia. I read it with new pleasure. Untamed prairie, Nebraska, red grass that stretched beyond sight. Settlers from Bohemia, twice foreigners new to a strange land where everyone was a kind of stranger. Desperate winters, loneliness, that clean, strong voice.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me. I am Jake Oresick. Many of you knew my father, Peter, who passed away last September, and Charlie was nice enough to ask me to come here and represent him, and I said, okay, well, but I'm not a Cather expert, and in fact, I don't know a lot more about Willa Cather than is included in the introduction of this book, which is available for only $5 in the back. And he said, that's fine, come and talk about that. But I think a cool thing about my father and his interest in Cather and his different projects, some of you know he wrote an entire book of poetry in 2008 about Andy Warhol, and that he really gets immersed in a subject. And I guess I inherited that because I wrote an entire book about Shenley High School, which is available in that. So we share that, but sometimes I would say, Dad, I love you and support you, but I don't know what it is that drew you to this or what makes you tick about this. So in his final year, I started to understand his interest in fascination and respect for Willa Cather. And as his health was failing, he had trouble with his vision. And he had written the introduction sometime before, but Carnegie Mellon Press wasn't ready, so there was this back and forth. And by the time they were ready, he said, would you mind, he said to me, would I mind going over the introduction and fixing any small typos, but if I had any other notes, we would orally go back and forth. So this led to a dialogue about it. And one thing that really struck out was, one thing that struck me was I knew about Paul's case, and that's really what I knew, and I did associate with Herbert the Midwest. And but something that he included that was pretty powerful was Pittsburgh was even more vital, more creative, more hungry for culture than New York. Pittsburgh was the birthplace of my writing. And that he really wanted people to see that, and that he had this, of course, a love for literature as a poet, as an English professor, as a University Press agent. But he also loved history, especially Pittsburgh history in this region. So all those interests coalesced around her because she had historical relevance. She had beautiful prose, and one thing that really became important to him at the end of his life was she really put Pittsburgh in her books. It's not like she just lived here and she wrote a book that was set on an anonymous island, or she lived here and she wrote a book that was set in New York City. And here's a little spoiler, that my father's last project was something called the Pittsburgh novel, where he loved seeing Pittsburgh in fiction so much as a point of regional self-esteem almost, but also saying these are the streets I walk, and it's cool to see, read about or see in film these fictitious characters walking them too, that he decided to catalog, speaking of obsessive, every novel, play, screenplay, television show with a substantial setting in Pittsburgh. So after he passed, I'm continuing that, and I realized that, you know, some have a minimal influence in Pittsburgh, they call it Pittsburgh, but they spend the whole play or the whole novel in some room and there's really no descriptive stuff. And sometimes it's almost like they're really trying to get a movie deal, that they're like, the character took a brooding walk on Mount Washington to clear his head. You know, like we all do, you know, no matter where we live. Because of course that's a great shot to have in a movie, and that they name all these proper nouns, but the book isn't actually very good. So as I was going through this and then coming back to Cather, and he does say it's such a great job, my father was spelling it out for us in the introduction of saying, she not only lived on these streets, but in this very perfectly subtle way, she weaves the Allegheny Cemetery and East Liberty Station and Carnegie Music Hall and Lower Hill District Central High School into her story, but that she doesn't beat you over the head with it, that they're, you know, normal settings. It's not like in some of these other pieces I read where somebody goes to PNC Park just to go to PNC Park. You know, that she really does this flawlessly. And it also shows that I think she had this affection for Pittsburgh and that she thought of herself as a true Pittsburgher. So it was very cool for me to learn from him through going back and forth about this introduction, not only so much about her life. But speaking of Thoreau, and reminiscent of your poem, that he gave on page 9, he gives this walking tour of everywhere she lived, 309 South Highland and Shadyside, 341 Sheridan East Liberty. You could really walk to all those places if you were a true Catherine, which he was. And I said, Dad, is it really necessary to put the addresses there? And before I even got out of my mouth, I said, of course it is. That's what we are Essex do. But so it was great to be able to share that with him. And you know, he loved, of course it was cool that she was prominent, but more prominent people or more famous pieces have referenced Pittsburgh, but not in so authentically and not so artfully. So yeah, that's all.
And notice the leading male performer asleep in the end of the car. She wrote, "His coat collar was turned up, his linen crumpled, the makeup still discolored his eyes. His face was damp with perspiration, and he looked gray and drawn and tired. It was Herr Canton von Rui, late of Walhalla, tired as a laborer from the iron mills. It is hard work, apparently," she wrote, "this being a god." And so it was high culture performance and the low iron worker, the stereotypical perception of the mill worker. Willa Cather had a specific experience with the steel mill at Homestead shortly after she arrived in Pittsburgh. For as Snyder and Byrne tell us in their book named Chrysalis, she went on a tour of the mills with the Gerwigs and Dorothy Canfield, her friends. At Homestead, she saw fountains of flames and workers moving like ants and heard what seemed to be a clanging inferno. Cather would visit the mills again and go on to write three editorial columns in the Lincoln Courier when the mill workers went on strike again in 1901, this time against United States Steel. Her general sentiment seemed to be a biting attack on a management, Carnegie, that only allowed strikes to happen when they had excess capacity and could afford the loss. If management was indeed micromanaging the work stoppages to their advantage, there still may be a veiled criticism by Cather of the workers themselves. At least that's how I read the following passage, and maybe they could have been more wily about their willingness negotiate. She wrote, "The press dispatchers, in figuring out the total losses to the steel corporations through the inactivity of the mills, have neglected to figure what the steel magnates would lose by meeting the weekly payroll when their warehouses are already overstocked, and an inevitable depression in the steel industry stares them in the face. It would seem but a common sense measure to strike when their labor is indispensable. The repeated occurrence of strikes when orders are light and work is slack would seem to indicate that the steel corporations of Pennsylvania and Ohio can avoid them when they find it expedient to do so, and that if they lose money through the idleness of their mills, they would lose more in the long run through their operation." Cather returned to Pittsburgh even after she had resettled to New York City, having moved there to take a managing editorship at McClure's magazine, not something unremarkable at the time for a woman, but probably very much like her complex relationship with the startling and sometimes hostile environment of Nebraska. She seems to have been ambivalent about this city. Let's see what you all think about that as well a little bit later. She famously called Pittsburgh the city of deplorable dirt, and I have it on good authority that she actually used that exact phrase. I was going back and forth trying to find where I had it in my head that that's what she said. But of course, it would have been very dusty and dirty all the time with all the industry and railroad. So she called it the city of deplorable dirt, and she also documents its unique topography and troubling environmental condition in the fiction she wrote. I'll just give you one example. In The Professor's Commencement, one of the stories that Peter has collected in his collection here, she writes that the heart of the city, which was like that of any other manufacturing town, a scene of bleakness and naked ugliness, and that remorseless desolation which follows upon the fiercest lust of man. She adeptly describes and combines the originally sublime landscape with the horrifying results of industry. The beautiful valley where long ago two limpid rivers met at the foot of wooded heights has become a scorched and blackened waste. Cather seems to have felt that habitation, industry, and the general tendency of humanity to populate and civilize some of our country's most dramatic and remarkable landscapes somehow compromised, bless you, us. In the same story she wrote, "To the west, across the river, rose the steep bluffs, faintly etched through the brown smoke, rising 500 feet, almost as sheer as a precipice, traversed by cranes and inclines and checkered by yellow, winding paths like sheep trails, which lead to the wretched habitations clinging to the face of the cliff, the lairs of the vicious and the poor, miserable rodents of civilization." It doesn't get much bleaker in a description like that. When Cather noted the deplorable nature of the mill workers' working conditions, she also pointed to the unlikeliness of said workers engaging in the cultural activities often associated with the leisure class. 12 hours, she wrote, 12-hour shifts are doubtless good economy, but they do not tend to make a literary or music-loving community. Thank goodness the days of 12-hour shifts, unless we're grieving, right, are behind us for most of us today, because thanks largely to the brave folks who fought in the past for union protection. Because many of us, though, are literary and music-loving, I am pleased to have this occasion to announce a concert to be formed as part of the 16th International Willa Cather Seminar to be held in Pittsburgh next month. The concert will feature pieces that Cather would have heard, commented upon, and was influenced by during her time living and working in Pittsburgh. And Tim reminded me that I had forgotten to write into this little presentation that my husband, Brett, is mentioned on this little flyer coming around, and he'll be doing an organ recital Monday, the first night, so we'll pass those out in case anyone's interested at the Calvary Church in the North Side. But we're also having a concert at the Carnegie Music Hall, which to my estimation seats 1,950 people. So again, we do want that to be filled. It's a free concert. And Cather was always enthusiastic and active as a consumer and patron of the arts, and she especially loved music. She attended scores of musical concerts and events in Pittsburgh when she was here, including concerts at the newly formed Pittsburgh Symphony in the just-opened Carnegie Music Hall in the Oakland section of the city. The concert planned for June 15th will be performed by the Washington Symphony Orchestra under the direction of CalU's very own Hugo Eyecatch. He's the department chair at CalU Music and Theater. At the very same Carnegie Music Hall in which Cather heard the music, the pieces on the program are being selected because of evidence that Cather heard these works in Pittsburgh during these years, or because she commented upon or used the musical works in her writing, or sometimes both. As a matter of fact, I have plenty of tickets here. They're free, but we want to make sure that we count for everybody. So I'd be happy to give those out at the end of this presentation. And so I very much hope to see many of you at that concert on the 15th of June. As an aside, I'm so pleased to have at our disposal and for future collaborations Peter Oresick's beautifully edited and introduced collection of stories in which Cather wrote about this city, aptly titled The Pittsburgh Stories of Willa Cather. Also, check out the Pittsburgh Arts and Lecture Series, which I believe your mother is in charge of. Is that right? Is that what I'm...
Lecture.
That wasn't fair of me. So, that is the case. Okay. Thanks. Thank you so much for your time. You've been a lovely audience. Thank you.
March of 1898,
And Cather's account of Homestead is unflinching and effectively documents her observations of Homestead at the time and her opinions on larger issues, such as the condition of the workers. And so in my talk today, I wanted to propose that the real Homestead can help us to understand some of her short stories more deeply, and I just wanted to focus on one today to go in more depth. And so this story, The Willing Muse, was published in Century Illustrated magazine in August of 1907. And while it's not considered one of the proper Pittsburgh stories, the description of fictional Olympia, Ohio resonates with her descriptions of Pittsburgh. And so this story traces the marriage of Kenneth Gray to Bertha Torrance. And in my initial readings of the story, I was struck not only by Cather's incorporation of industrialization, but how her primary characters, both of whom are writers, are judged by their industriousness, their output of material. The conflict between popular or commercial art and true craftsmanship or artistry would become an important theme in Cather's fiction and in her own artistic philosophy is. And while the few critics who comment on this story tend to view Kenneth as a stand-in for Cather's own preferred approach to work, I'd like to argue that this story can take on a new significance when viewed in light of the larger social conversations that surround industrialization, labor, productivity, and leisure in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. And in particular, I'm interested in tracing how Kenneth and Bertha respond to the survival of the fittest atmosphere where their fitness is measured by their productivity rather than their artistry. Critical commentary on The Willing Muse is pretty slight. In a book called Willa Cather's Imagination, author David Stout summarizes the story in this way. It was very helpful. In the story, an impractical and unworldly novelist marries a woman who is also a writer, but her ambition far exceeds his, and eventually he is reduced to being her secretary and publicity agent. In the end, he saves himself by leaving her and disappearing altogether. He goes to China. Stout's verdict on the story is that it is contrived and imitative of Henry James. And indeed, the most frequent way of approaching this story is that it's part of Cather's earlier imitations of Henry James's story is. More frequently, critics cite this story as an example of Cather's objections to industrialization. And I would like to look at this piece in connection to The Real Homestead, which provides us with direct evidence for Cather's experiences and observations. And this article focuses on the incompatibility between the capitalists' investments in libraries and performing arts spaces and the workers' inability to use such facilities due to the capitalists' hard-driving labor practices. Cather explains to her readers that the mill workers operate in exhausting, non-stop 12-hour shifts. And as Kim included this quote in her piece as well, she explains to her readers that 12-hour shifts are doubtless good economy, but they do not tend to make a literary or music-loving community. The library, she explains, is full of good things that no one has the leisure to enjoy. If a man, quote, has been working all day in the most exhausting temperature, probably drinking heavily to combat the heat, he wants no music or books or athletics, but all the sleep that he can get before resuming his shift the next day. And in this article, Cather also comments on the town itself, which she describes as neglected and unlovely in appearance. She writes, on Saturday night, when the mills are running, there is not a noisier spot on earth, nor a more interesting study for the sociologist. In Cather's story, The Willing Muse, scholars have seen a parallel between the fate of the writer, Kenneth Gray, and that of his hometown, Olympia, Ohio. Once a bucolic village, home to a college and many literary residents, Kenneth explains that Olympia has been ruined completely due to invading industrialization, and that the place is black with smoke and thick with noise from sunrise to sunset. While this displacement from Olympia certainly impacts Kenneth, I would like to argue that more importantly in this story, Cather is grappling with the changing nature of literary work. As Cather's letters and her correspondence to family indicate,
And you can find those in the newly published Selected Letters of Willa Cather. There's a great section in there on her letters about her move to Pittsburgh and all the work that she was doing for various newspapers and magazines and eventually as a school teacher here in the city. She found this work incompatible, oftentimes, with working on her own writing. And while the work that Cather performed and the work of her characters in this story, Kenneth and Bertha, as writers, can hardly be compared to the intense labor that Carnegie's workers experienced in the mills, Kenneth and Bertha are both routinely evaluated on the basis of their productivity. At the beginning of the story, Kenneth's friends find the slow pace of his writing to be charming, but it also exhausts their patience. The story is narrated by one of Kenneth's friends named Philip, and he drops in for a visit after several years away. He complains to Kenneth, "What are you doing, anyhow? I don't know where you'll ever learn productivity in industry if Bertha can't teach you. I'm working," is Kenneth's response. In turning to Bertha, David Stout describes her as vampire-like because she becomes even more radiant and energetic as her husband takes on more and more of the editorial duties that might impede her progress. I would like to argue, though, that I don't think that Bertha is a sinister villain in this story who's exploiting her husband. Bertha has adapted to these new labor conditions much more than her husband has, but she also doesn't seem to have the unlimited leisure time that was enjoyed by some of the industrial capitalists like Andrew Carnegie or J.P. Morgan. At the end of the day, Bertha is still a laborer and one who is judged solely for the amount of writing that she can produce. In her Homestead article, Cather critiqued the survival of the fittest philosophies put forth by Herbert Spencer and embraced by the industrial capitalists. She writes, and this is a quote, that an ideal democracy, that is one that is a complete and consistent democracy, would completely disapprove of all of Herbert Spencer's system of philosophy. In the end of The Willing Muse, Kenneth's disappearance from the world, essentially he goes on a permanent strike, seems to be an attempt to remove himself from the survival of the fittest literary marketplace. This ending suggests that while individuals may not be able to shape the market forces surrounding them, they can decide to opt out and leave that system entirely. The story ends, however, without knowing if Kenneth's removal from society and these market forces allow him to write or even to be happy. Ultimately, a consideration of Cather and her connections to Pittsburgh encourages us in Cather studies to return to some of the under-examined pieces of her work, including fictional stories like The Willing Muse or others that are collected in Pittsburgh Stories, in order to understand this important, influential time in her development as a writer. And I think that more broadly, a study of these pieces can illustrate moments in literary and cultural history and help us to understand how writers and citizens reacted to or were impacted by the changing industrial practices at the turn of the century. Thank you.
Advanced slides at the same time, so it seems like we're getting going here. Good afternoon, and I want to thank Charlie for inviting us here to join in the celebration of Peter Oresick's book. And it's a timely collection, and it's a great asset to our international seminar, which is coming up very, very soon at the end of our middle of next month. And in making it so affordable, I think they were thinking of our seminarians who are going to be carrying this around for several miles of pavement as we go on walking tours of three neighborhoods. And I'd like to invite you, even if you don't want to pay $425 to join us for the whole thing, join us for the neighborhood tours. You might have a handout with that information if you think you might be interested. And for the free concerts, which are a an orchestral concert in Carnegie Music Hall with a 60-person orchestra, and the fine program that Kim and Brad have put together is really worth coming out for. I'd also recommend $5 for this book. It's a real bargain, just for the chronology in the back. And the selection of stories is also first grade. As a teaching volume, it will be great to have the professor's commencement beside Paul's case, which are two stories from the different sides of the podium, 1902 and 1905. And it's just going to be a great tool for us to use. For some time, I've been working on filling out a chronology of Cather's Pittsburgh decade, 1896 to 1906, and she also visited here and spent long working vacations through 1916. So we have that second decade to think about, too. And I think with the record that we have and with a little more research, we can fill in what she was doing, where she was, her activities for every week of that decade. And probably for many of those weeks, we can pin it down every day. In that spirit, I'd like to try today to look at her September 1896 trip to Homestead, the first one. And I've got some pictures here, hoping to flesh that out. Now, the only person that she knew in Pittsburgh, in greater Pittsburgh, when she came here on June 26, 1896, which Kim changed that date. Before we thought it was July 3rd, but it was actually June 26th. The only person she knew was George William Gerwig, who lived in Allegheny City. And he was the newly elected Secretary of Education in Allegheny. And he had been married for 3 weeks at that time. So he was a newlywed. But he took Willa Cather and her friends gallivanting all around Pittsburgh and Allegheny City. And for a time I wondered, why didn't his wife mind? Because Willa Cather has been the other woman in my life for so long. But we found out that she was actually in mourning because her mother had passed away. And she was observing a customary year of mourning, so she wasn't going anywhere. She wasn't socially active. She herself died in 1901, so she outlived her mother by only 5 years. They had 3 kids, and she died with the birth of the third baby. George, by some accounts, had recommended her name to James Wycliffe Axtell, publisher of the National Stockman and Farmer, a stock magazine of East Liberty, who thought that Pittsburgh needed a new women's magazine. And eventually he called out the Home Monthly. George knew that Willa could launch and run a magazine by herself because she had commandeered a magazine at the University of Nebraska when they were both there. And she took it over, and the other staff members said that it was all Willa. She did it all herself. She wouldn't let them do anything. So she applied all her energy during those few first months to the Home Monthly, soliciting articles from her friends, including George, setting up the pages in the press room, haggling with illustrators, and writing a quarter of the magazine herself under a dozen pseudonyms. Actually, we think there are 15 pseudonyms at this point. And one of our Cather trivia questions is going to be, can anyone in the audience name all those 15? There's one woman who we know can do that. Her letters mention that in her spare time, good Mr. Gerwig ushered her around the Twin Cities. But they don't mention their visit to Homestead, which makes me think that the source of information was Dorothy Canfield, who was then 17 years old. She was the daughter of the president of Ohio State University. James Canfield, her father, had been chancellor of the University of Nebraska when George and Willa were there. And the Canfields lived in Columbus, like Kelsey. So the next year when Willa got the flu really bad, she went to recuperate with the Canfields and she took them the flu. But it was life-threatening. We could have lost her in 1897. People were dying all the time. Kim read a brief quotation about workers at Homestead moving like ants in a clanging inferno. And I think those were probably Dorothy Canfield's words when she was interviewed by E.K. Brown for the first major biography of Cather in 1953. But she was the only one alive at that point who could have told him that. A friend who knows Dorothy Canfield's fiction, later Dorothy Canfield Fisher, and she published a lot as a major novelist, doesn't think that she ever mentioned Homestead in her novels or short stories. Nor did Willa Cather immediately, but George Gerwig did. In a children's story for the October issue of the Home Monthly. And mercifully for you, we don't have time for me to ask you to read the two-page story, but I'll give you a synopsis, and we're working on illustrations. But it was written by a German-American who became a local authority on character education. And Patsy insists that the better sort of Irish have the potential to be brave and loyal workers. Patsy is a mill boy, and he's given a job in the mill after his father dies trying to rescue a colleague who's killed in an accident. And he's a wide-awake boy and curious, so he befriends the supervisor, Mr. Hayes, who runs the steam engine. And one of the things that Patsy wants to learn is how to start and stop the steam engine, so you almost know what's going to happen from the first page of the story, from the first paragraph. Patsy's first challenge occurs when another mill boy, a shiftless German youth called Dutchie, so we have the Patsy and Dutchie so far. I won't tell you what his dog's name is, but it's a black dog and you can imagine that. But Dutchie is caught in a tangle of hot steel near the rod mill. As Dutchie is pulled screaming toward the rollers, Patsy grabs the red hot metal with his bare hands and wrenches it free from his legs. So Dutchie is permanently disabled, incapacitated, but Patsy is recognized for heroism, and he's put in the general office to run the telephone, to answer the telephone while his burnt hands heal. So he's rewarded for his heroism. And like Andrew Carnegie, who's one of his first jobs is learning to run the telegraph, Patsy is put onto this new technology. So he'd be probably writing apps today if he were working for a company. The story's climax occurs after Patsy returns to the work line. The flywheel shatters on the great steam engine, instantly killing Mr. Hayes. And the dynamo running at top speed begins shaking the mill to pieces and throwing shards of metal and wood all over the place. As the full-grown men flee for their lives, Patsy runs toward the danger, and he shuts down the engine, saving many lives and much property. Patsy is promoted for his bravery and years later becomes the universally respected general manager of the mill. Unlike her good friend Mr. Gerwig, Cather had few algeresque illusions about virtue rewarded. Even her children's stories are often gruesome and seldom simple. For example, in the story she wrote for the December issue of the Home Monthly, Santa Claus's reindeer are massacred by their werewolf dog. They all die. And she had about as much regard for the Iron Masters as reindeer. She sent a column back to the Nebraska State Journal in early 1897 that claimed that Henry Clay Frick wasn't shot at all, as everyone here knows, but his would-be assassin is doing time in the pen just the same. Her fake news story perhaps reflected her dismay upon seeing conditions at Homestead a few months before, and I think Charlie mentioned in one of the programs that Judge McClung, who was later Cather's host for like the 10 or 20 years that she moved off of it, was the judge who put Alexander Berkman away for the maximum sentence. Cather returned to Homestead in March 1898 to visit Mary Robbins, and Kelsey's mentioned this visit, a Nebraskan who was cataloging books for the soon-to-open Carnegie Library. 3 years later, she mocked Carnegie for providing his employees working 12-hour turns, music and books and athletics when all they really wanted was all the sleep they could get before 4:30 in the morning. She finally made use of her first Homestead visit after 5 years in the August 24th, 1901 editorial called The Real Homestead, which Kelsey has commented on. And this was on the occasion of another strike against J.P. Morgan's U.S. Steel. And here are some of the bullet points from that article. The downwind trees across the river are dead or dying from the pollution. The skilled workers eat well, and most of them have more money than taste, so they had more disposable income than taste, she thought, in decorating the house. The foreign labor element were brought into Pottersville in 1892 and had never had the ambition to get outside the stop pen. That's a direct quote. And the whiskey drunk in Homestead every Saturday night would float an ocean steamer. Brutalizing toil was followed by brutalizing pleasures. And a comment from her 1898 return visit, the Carnegie Library is full of good things and no one has the leisure to enjoy. So, in her most famous story, Paul's Case, 1905, the second story in Peter's volume, Cather created a dandy who liked to hear the legends of the Iron Kings, of triumphs of cash boys who had become famous, although Paul had no mind for the cash boy stage. Unlike Patsy, Andrew Carnegie, and other diligent youth who put in their time as mill helpers, clerks, or telegraph boys, Paul had no patience for thrift and self-improvement. Instead, he steals his employer's cash deposit and runs away to New York to his destiny. Now a well-dressed fugitive, Paul reflects as he sips champagne in the dining room of the Waldorf Astoria. Wealth is what all the world is fighting for. This is what all the struggle was about. And while Cather endorses neither his theft nor his eventual suicide, I think she does suggest a comparison between his ill-gotten gains and the wealth of the Pittsburgh steelmen who were frequenting the same luxury hotels. So I think there's a bit of commentary going on there. At the story's climax, Paul decides to end it all splendidly by jumping in front of an ongoing locomotive, which most critics interpret as symbolic of the limitless power, social privilege, and vengefulness of the Pittsburgh steel masters. So he takes his swan dive in front of the locomotive. Outside Patsy's fantasy world, there's no stopping this engine. Cather's early exposure to Homestead did not enter her fiction immediately, but reinforced her habitual skepticism about the captains of industry that remained with her throughout her career. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlie. My name is Len Barkowski, and I can only be described as an appreciative reader of Willa Cather. But I do have a couple of thoughts to share with you. And as Henry VIII said to pretty much all of his wives, I promise I shall not keep you long. Much is made of the fact that Willa Cather. And often they're surprised that Willa Cather had spent so much time here in Pittsburgh. I don't think there's any reason for any of us to be surprised because, like Willa Cather, we are all Midwesterners here in southwestern Pennsylvania, and we are all, whether one, two, or eight generations removed, we are all immigrants, like so many of her characters. I'm also planning on talking for a couple of minutes about her long career as a journalist. It was work that she didn't necessarily enjoy or take the greatest of satisfaction from, but it was something she did for a very long time. And finally, just I'd like to remind all of you that Willa Cather and the places she knew, so many of them are still with us and still serve the same purposes that they served 120 years ago. We're Midwesterners. You go west, and it's pretty much flat until you reach the Rocky Mountains. There are some occasional changes in topography, but for the most part, once you leave, get a little bit west of Pittsburgh, it's flat till you get to the Rockies. However, going east, you go an hour and a half, and you're in the mountains. And you got to go about 2.5 hours before you really cross that eastern continental divide, where the rivers start flowing into the Atlantic rather than to the Gulf of Mexico. Our rivers flow into the Gulf, and I think more than anything else, that makes us part of the Midwest, along with the people that Cather wrote about. And of course, our accent is not the accent of Philadelphia or of the Lehigh Valley where I grew up, where the Pennsylvania Dutch influence is so strong. And it's certainly not the accent of the hard coal regions of Luzerne and Lackawanna and Schuylkill counties, where my parents came from. And I also think we're Midwesterners in that there is both a directness and a friendliness in those of us who live here. And Cather lived here for a long time. As other speakers have noted, she was here pretty much full time for a decade, and then she visited regularly with her lifelong friend Isabella McClure for the better part of another 10 years. Her long career as a journalist, where I think she developed what Lynn-Ann described as a clear, strong voice. Her career as a journalist started out very early with an 1891 essay on Thomas Carlyle, which she wrote and was published when she was still in high school. I identified with her good fortune in having had that early training, because to my amazement at this point, I've had the good fortune to have spent 47 years writing for newspapers. And still, there are those opportunities for both beginners and for people and people who are experienced to get a first chance at seeing their work in print or online, depending on whether or not it's a print or an online publication, that newspapers with stories done in a day continues to offer. They offered that to Willa Cather, and they continue to offer that. When she came here, it was to work for the Home Monthly, which is described, at least it sounds to me, kind of a sort of a family, women's, Saturday Evening Post. Kind of think of it as a print version of Garrison Keillor's Prairie Home Companion. A little bit of everything in that publication. And I'm not going to give away the answer to the question of how many pseudonyms did Cather use when she worked for the Home Companion. But I will give you my favorite, and that list is available in Kathleen Burns and Richard Snyder's biography of Cather. And the names are downright Dickensian, many of them, or seem to maybe be prefiguring the kind of names that P.G. Woodhouse gives his characters in the Wooster books. The one name that my own favorite name along that list is, again, among 15, did you say? 15 different, 15 different names is Helen DeLay. Yeah, Helen DeLay. DeLay. And if there's one thing Cather did not do during her time in Pittsburgh, it was delay anything. She was constantly busy. Final point, Cather's world really is all around us. The home where she lived, the home belonging to the father of her friend Isabella McClung, is still in Pittsburgh on Murray Hill Avenue, a very important part of our life here in Pittsburgh, as is Carnegie Music Hall. There was a period where she lived just up on Craig Street, a few blocks away from the Carnegie Music Hall and the Carnegie Library, and wrote extensively about the performers and the musicians that she saw there. And for her, I think the Carnegie Library, I'd like to think that the Carnegie Library was, whatever her objections to, and they are valid objections, to the man whose money provided that structure. My sense is that the Carnegie Library was a welcoming place for her when she would have an opportunity between the multiple stories she was writing, was as welcoming a place for her as it has been for me 120 years later as I worked on various projects involving Pittsburgh history. Going back very briefly to that first point about we are all Midwesterners, we are all immigrants. Cather's Central Europeans, Bohemians, another term I guess for Czechs, Slovaks, Swedes, Norwegians. One of the things they had obviously in common was they were the other, separated by thousands of miles, and often language difficulties, and different cultures and religions. One of the things that comes through to me, one of the things that I find personally so moving in Cather's stories, Old Pioneers, my aunt and Mia especially, is all four of my grandparents came to America from Lithuania. Neither of my grandmothers spoke more than a few words of English, even having lived for a very long time in the New World. And all of them, I'm sure, had periods where they were isolated from the culture they knew, the religion that they were most familiar with, the habits that they had known as children and as girls. Cather helps bring that world to life for me, including the challenges of living in this new world. And Cather, in her books, does not take a rosy view of the difficulty of life on the Great Plains, or the difficulties of trying to make a living in Pittsburgh, where the money was, where most jobs were involved long hours under really difficult conditions. But in those books, the dignity of those characters continues to shine, and it is one of the things that makes reading Cather's novels, reading Cather's short stories, a continuing pleasure and a continuing inspiration for readers well into the 21st century.
Yeah, I didn't want to second that, because that's something that I very much feel with my Anthony. It is such a powerful view. Like I say, I have a real hard time wrapping my head around the masculinity of the narrator, which I'm happy to hear any comments that the people know much more than I do. But what is so extraordinary is that she's the boy, and Cather too, is transported from Winchester, Virginia, because his parents die, and he is sent to Nebraska to live with the grandparents, and they are emerging literally out of the sod houses and into the wood houses of having worked 10 or 15 years, but around them are coming the Bohemians and the Slavs. And her picture of them, of course, Antonia is the great symbol of this. I mean, there is no ethnic looking down on her part. She actually, what she traces is this energy and the hard work, especially the women who are just breaking horses, digging the prairie, baking in the, because then her family, the grandparents are getting old, they move to the town. She records how the Slavic girls come in, starting out as the servants at the houses, and within a generation of running everything. They're running everything in that town. They know the railroads, they know the granaries, they know it from the ground up. It's such a tribute to working class knowledge rooted in soil and work and listening and learning. Meanwhile, her own type of people in the women in the houses more or less exposed, not going out much, being very limited in who they are, and of course thinking they're superior to these